well, as they have done for the last 7 times now that they've played South Africa in the T20 World Cup. England won the toss and they, on this occasion, elected to field first. That's what we expected. We expected a quick scoring pitch. It didn't really turn out that way. South Africa made 163 for 6, despite Quinton de Kock scoring a quick fire 65 from 38 balls. In response, England stuttered and struggled, got off to a reasonable start, but in the end it just was all a little bit timid and hard to get away until Harry Brook and Liam Livingstone put on together a good partnership. 21 came from the 17th over. At that point, England needed 25 runs from 18 balls, but some fine bowling at the end saw them finishing 7 runs short. So, Jeff Lemon, it leaves things rather open in this group. What do we make of it all?
Well, things could go in a few different directions from here. We've got the 4 teams in the group: South Africa, England, the USA, West Indies. So basically, if South Africa beat West Indies and England beat the USA, England will go through. They'll be fine. But if that result is inverted, you could end up with 3 teams on 4 points each. England should have South Africa covered on net run rate. They're behind them at the moment, but if South Africa lose to West Indies, they'll lose a bit. And if England beat the USA, they'll gain a bit. But if it were a very narrow win for England and a narrow loss for South Africa, then they might not make up that net run rate gap. So it is still in play. You've got those 3 teams all in play there. And the USA have only played one of their games. They could win 2 as well and end up on 4 points.
Oh, goodness me. I thought we were done with net run rate, Finney. Nope. What do we make of England's performance today? Because it was a funny old game, this. Not really what we expected.
No, I think both power plays have hurt them, really. I don't think they adapted to conditions quick enough inside the first 6 overs with the ball. They allowed Quinton de Kock to get away to a flying start. The only person, really, who played with any fluency, David Miller, scored relatively quickly as well, but that was thrashing around. At the end, the only person who batted inside the first 15 overs with fluency in the entire game was Quinton de Kock. And then with the bat in hand, the South African bowlers, I think, learned what had worked for the England bowlers in terms of changing their pace, taking pace off the ball inside those first 6 overs, not letting the batters just hit through the line of it. And it meant that 22-run swing within the power play was what ended up being fatal for England.
England will be really frustrated to have taken it so close, Jeff, and fought back in the way that they did. 25 from 18, 6 wickets in hand. You'd expect most teams to win that 9 times out of 10.
You would. They got a bit of a gift to get them there, though, in the form of that over from Othniel Bartman, who bowled 5 full tosses, hit the pitch once in the over, got smashed around. That was really what turned the tide. And coming into the last 5 overs, England needed 59 off 30, and this wasn't a surface on which that was an easy thing to do. There would be some games where you'd back a batting team to do that. Most times, this didn't look like that kind of pitch, and at that point it looked like very much South Africa's game. So it swung a few times. The Bartman over happens. England are on top, are in the better position for that last 3 overs, but quality bowling closes it out, and they're able to take those wickets of Livingstone and Brook and slow the progress down enough that Sam Curran couldn't do it on his own at the end.
How will England feel, do you think, Finney? Because it's one of those games where you could easily have won it at the end, could easily have lost it by quite a few more runs if things hadn't quite gone their way in that over.
Yeah, after the game, I think Josh Butler sounded upbeat about what they'd done. I think they did some good things in the game that they can take confidence from, but it's that power play with the ball again, as it was against Australia, that left them scrambling around and chasing their tails a bit through the latter stages or the final 14 overs of their bowling innings. They dragged it back well today. I thought in the middle overs and towards the end they bowled excellently, but certainly there's still some room to improve on if they do end up bowling first, which seems to be their preference in order their way to win games here. You can't gift people runs in the power play and then be chasing, catching it up after that.
Well, let's hear from the England captain as to where he thought things went wrong. Down on the boundary edge, I spoke to Joss Butler after play.
Yeah, obviously disappointed to lose the game. I thought it was a really good game of cricket, lots of ebbs and flows. I think the difference really was de Kock in the power play. I thought he played really well, and the power play was probably the best time to score, and we couldn't quite maximise the use of that, and de Kock certainly did.
Was that because the surface didn't quite behave as we all expected, I think, having seen other games here?
Yeah, maybe a day game. It's a bit drier and a bit slower. I think it certainly played a little bit like that. I thought the bowling performance, I said, after the first six, we were outstanding. The way we restricted them to 116 was probably about par, I thought. So we were confident of chasing it down. But I thought they bowled well in the power play, didn't let us to get away. And credit to Brooke and Livingston for getting it so close. And then, like I say, the ebbs and flows, you probably looked like favourites at that point. But on that kind of wicket, it's never quite as simple as that.
As a captain watching on, I mean, you're powerless. It must be really difficult when you know a team, your side's getting so close, then you have the setback. I mean, how do you cope with that?
Yeah, okay. I've seen a lot of cricket. And, you sit there and you put trust in the guys, and they were playing brilliantly well. I thought, like I say, not a straightforward surface, the way Brooke and Livingston put that partnership together. And like you say, you're probably at one point looking favourites there. It was a great effort. So, yeah, shame we couldn't go all the way, but we still played. Did a lot of good things today.
And then the USA up next, which is going to be an unusual, a new fixture for you guys. It's a fixture that you're looking at now, and you've got to approach, I suppose, like the Namibia and Oman games, where net run rate, all those considerations come in.
Yeah, we just have to try and win the game. And we haven't played against the USA before, so looking forward to that. The games come thick and fast, so you dust yourself down and go again.
Do you feel just finally that you're getting proper cricket now after the bitty group stage? It feels a little bit more like a proper tournament for you.
Yeah, it does. Like I say, games are coming thick and fast, and we've had a great game against the West Indies. Another good game today. Shame we couldn't win the game, but we're still in it, and we look forward to the next one.
Well, as you said, Stephen, it was that power play, and it was the efforts of Quinton de Kock that he cites as the difference between the two sides.
Yeah, he played brilliantly, didn't he? And he used the pace. He waited for his time to be able to attack. England held the quick bowlers back until the fourth over, wasn't it? It was Topley, Moeen, Topley, and then Archer bowled the fourth over. And I think de Kock just sensed his time. He knew that Jofra Archer was going to come in and try and hit the pitch hard. He went 6-4. Six, I think it was, inside those first three or four balls, and put Archer on the back foot, and it was brilliant batting, and he just continued that momentum throughout the power play, and it really was his innings that was the difference between the two teams. Could England have adapted to him sooner? Yes, definitely. That's something that they'll reflect on now, but I think you have to marvel at the brilliance of de Kock inside those first six overs to get South Africa into the position they found themselves.
It's such a stark contrast with everybody else in this game. Just about, you look at the other players in his lineup. Reeza Hendricks had a strike rate in the 70s. Henrik Claassen was in the 60s. Butler and Bairstow on the other side were striking in the 80s, which is very slow for them in T20 cricket. And then you've got Quinton de Kock striking at 171 and turning in the biggest score that anybody made in the game. It was an extraordinary effort, really. And we didn't clock how extraordinary it was, because he started things off. He was the first one out there, so we assumed it must be a decent surface to bat on, judging by just how easy he made it look. But everybody else's struggles showed up the quality of that innings.
In terms of England's bowling, Finney, you look again at the figures of Adil Rashid. 4 overs, 1 for 20. But also, I want to point out Rhys Topley. 4 overs, didn't get a wicket, but only 23 runs conceded. And he spoke to us earlier in the week and talked about how, as a T20 bowler, you don't have to just focus on wickets. Economy is a vital part of the role, and he's doing a brilliant job.
Yeah, and inside that power play as well against Australia, it was something that was highlighted, was that they were missing someone who is really a specialist at bowling in the power play. And I don't mean that as to the detriment of his other aspects, but I think clearly the left arm swing from his height is a very potent threat. That's why he's typically bowled 3 overs or at least 2 overs in the power play for England when he's played through this World Cup. So yeah, he's come into the team, he's done well. He had to wait for his opportunity. He's missed out in a couple of World Cups because of cruel injuries, but really he's taken his opportunity here. 4 overs for 23 was a good return for him, especially inside that power play with the way de Kock was playing.
Yep, and England looked like they've found how they want to open the bowling in this tournament. But Jeff, a little statistical quirk that, not necessarily a quirk, but maybe more actually an indication of something a little more worrying, came from our scorer Andy Zaltzman, who pointed out that England have conceded 390 runs in opening stands across 6 matches. And the highest in a men's T20 World Cup is Namibia, who 400 conceded, in two more games. So England have struggled to open sort of the innings up and break partnerships.
Well, the positive way of looking at that is in one more game, England can break a record, and that's something that everybody likes to see, you know, to have that sense of achievement, to have something to call their own. If they could do that, well, they've got a couple more opportunities at it, don't they? Coming up with the USA next. So if they can just put on 11, the USA openers, then England are into the lead free and clear. It's interesting. Topley has been super economical. That none for 23 today, none for 26 against the West Indies, none for 6 against Namibia, none for 12 against Oman in shortened games where they weren't bowling so many overs. But it hasn't resulted in him taking the wickets, but it's potentially helped to build pressure at the other end, you would think. Well, that would be the rationale, but the stats indicate that the wickets haven't been coming. So has that just been a case that England have been able to suppress scores through the power play to the point where it didn't matter? If those opening wickets weren't falling, it's not something that you can do for a long period of time and not expect to get punished for it. And in a way, they got away with it to a point today because Reeza Hendricks scored so slowly and he wasn't just finding one and feeding Quinton de Kock the strike. He was getting bogged down at one end himself, faced, I think, 8 dot balls in the 25 that he faced and went along at that slow strike rate. But South Africa still ended the power play going at 10 and over, and that ends up being the difference. England made, 41 off their power play and South Africa over 60. So you can't be handing out an advantage like that and not expect that it won't come back to bite you.
In terms of the positives for England, Harry Brook made 53, backing up that 47 not out he got against Namibia. 53 from 37 balls, no sixes in theirs, but that, Stephen, almost tells its own story because it was a very controlled innings. Everything he hit to the boundary was along the ground. He didn't look to be trying to take too many chances because he really backed himself to get England over the line.
Yeah, and he also came in with the score at 54 for 3 after just under 9 overs. So he'd have had a lot of work to do, but understood also that with Chris Jordan not playing, you had a lesser batter in Jofra Archer coming in at number 8. So you're in this perilous position as a batter then to say, well, I need to keep the scoreboard moving here, but I need to make sure that I do it with as little risk as possible, and then sense your opportunities on a bowler to take down and really try and make the most of that. So it was a mature innings. He's a guy that I really, really like. I think he has the ability to bat anywhere from numbers 1 to 7 in the batting order, and he has the power to bat and hit sixes towards the end, but also the technical ability to bat further up the order. So to have him floating around in that middle order is a very positive thing. He'll feel better for having spent 37 balls in the middle, but then he'll also be disappointed that having done all the hard work with him and Liam Livingston to get England needing 25 from those final 3 overs, that they didn't get over the line.
Selection-wise, we were wondering how England would approach today. No Chris Jordan, instead Mark Wood played, bowled 2 overs, none for 22. Can you understand what England's thinking was, and do you think they'll feel they got that wrong?
It's a difficult one, is it? We all love Mark Wood. Like, there's no, you run in and you're watching him bowl in 90-odd miles an hour and it's exciting, but I just think when you're looking at the makeup of this team now, what they're crying out for is someone else to partner Jofra Archer at the death. The number 8 hitting is a very important component, especially if, as we anticipate, as England leave St. Lucia, the wickets are going to continue to be a bit lower, a bit slower. And that batting at number 8 and hitting could be vitally important as well. So look, I think they'll definitely contemplate what needs to be done between now and the next game, but I would anticipate that would probably be the change that they'll go for.
It was an odd one seeing him come on to bowl his first over in the 14th, I think it was. Having gone through other options, they did bowl Moen a little more than you might normally expect to do, so that was part of it, with spin slowing things down after that power play. It was the 4 or 5 overs after the power play where the breaks really went on, and then England were able to take those first couple of wickets, get Hendricks trying to force the pace, and having Quinton de Kock caught but not given out, and then a couple of overs later eventually dismissed, and they were able to slow Klaassen down. So to a point, they didn't need Mark Wood. They had him as an option where, it had this pitch been a bit truer and a bit quicker, which it ended up not being, you know, that was the expectation. Had the surface played differently, we might have seen Mark Wood used differently. But in the end, England didn't necessarily need him. I mean, they held South Africa after that big flourish in the power play. They held South Africa really well, held them to a score that they should have chased, really. And this is a game that England had in their control and were able to let it slip.
That's a little bit of Jofra Archer watch, Finney, because we've been fascinated to see how he's going to go this tournament. 21 runs came off his first over, but he did finish in the end with a couple of wickets, three wickets, two in two balls. And I think recovered very well from that, only 19 runs coming from his next three overs.
He bowls the hard overs. I think that's the first and foremost thing to remember. He doesn't hide in the middle. He bowls in the power play and he bowls at the death. And I think one of his great skills actually is if he does have a bad over, and he can do every now and again have a bad over at the beginning, as anyone can do in the power play, he learns and is really intelligent with what he then uses from his bowling options for the rest of the innings. And he has that high pace, but he also recognises that you don't need to use that all of the time. So I thought he adapted well. He just might have wanted to adapt a bit quicker in that first over where the pace is exactly what Quinton de Kock wanted.
What about South Africa then? Because they've sort of stumbled their way to a fine unbeaten run, but today it felt like a much more complete performance perhaps than we've seen up to now.
I wouldn't agree with that at all.
Would you not?
Today felt like a performance that rode on the shoulders of Quinton de Kock opening. Their power hitting couldn't do it through the middle. They struggled with, Klaassen couldn't get moving, Hendricks couldn't get moving, Markram bumped himself down the list. In the end, Miller was vitally important, as he has been. He's been the one they've been relying on through this entire tournament. But it feels again like everything has to be left up to David Miller, who ends up getting them just enough. And then, look, it is a decent bowling performance coming in second. They're able to apply the strangle after the power play and not give away so much in the power play. So they were better with the ball there, but then, that over from Bartman almost coughs up the game. So there are big weaknesses for me in the South African team and the way that they are approaching games at this point.
Yeah, weaknesses, yes, but considering how close they were run by teams far less capable than England, I would look at that and say, we've got your opener smashing 65 when he was struggling at the start of the tournament before a score. You've got David Miller, who's being consistent. A middle order, they haven't necessarily fired, but they got a par score against some fine bowling before managing to defend it. And always the accusation with South Africa in the latter stages of tournaments is they get under pressure and they wilt. They didn't do that today. I think that is a mark of improvement.
Holding the nerve with the ball was an important step. The South African wilting is sometimes the other way around. Batting second, that's tended to be a situation where things have gone awry. But I don't look at that batting scorecard for South Africa and see a lot to be confident in for them going forward.
Finney, have you seen anything that makes you think they could be lifting that trophy?
Yeah, I have said consistently since before the tournament even started that I do see them as viable threats. I think there are areas that they clearly need to brush up on, whether they'll consider bringing Shamsi in again. That last bowling slot seems to be a fluid one for them, but when you look at the names that they have in that team and the IPLs that they've had, that there's enough there for them to be able to win the tournament. And I think actually it will help them, having held their nerve in a number of close games now, that when they do find themselves in that situation again, that they can recall those memories and those good memories to carry them over the line. It's what they need to play three more good games now, and they're winning the tournament.
You don't see it happening, do you?
Well, not to say that it can't happen. Obviously, that's the nature of these kind of tournaments, is anybody can win a couple in a row if things go their way. But they're not a side that fills me with much belief.
Righto. Okay. Well, we will see how it all plays out, because the group looks like this at the moment. South Africa, top of the pile on 4 points. England are on 2. USA play West Indies in the early hours of Saturday morning. Realistically, England win that game well against the USA, they'll be fine and they'll go through, but it is not a done deal. Is that where we are with this?
Essentially, yes. If they win it heavily and the South Africa West Indies thing is a bit of a something that could shake things up, but that should be enough, given that South Africa's two wins have been narrow wins. If they lose their other game, then they're in trouble. If they win the other game, they knock out West Indies and England can go through with any any flavour of win or tie or washout or whatever it may be against the USA.
Finney, just finally, as despondent as England fans were after the Australia game, elated as they were after West Indies, where should they feel at the moment after that?
Well, I like their heads are in a washing machine, I think. It's been a rollercoaster of emotions, hasn't it, following England through this tournament. There was a lot to be pleased about today. There's a lot to take confidence from. The Livingston and Brook partnership, Adil Rashid continues to be brilliant. It's just those power plays. They need to make sure that in these final however many games they play in this tournament, that right from the very beginning of the match, that they're on it, they're reading conditions, they're communicating about conditions. And I think if they do that, they've still got every component that is necessary to make it right to the very end.
Still feels like there's lots of questions, Jeff.
Plenty of questions. There are questions about every team, I think, every group, every setup, all of the ramifications of things that could happen. That's the nice bit about following a tournament. We don't know anything, and yeah, we're just throwing little flares into the dark.